Good afternoon, student friends. Welcome to the lecture on clay mineralogy, and we'll start a new chapter on shear strength of soils. Let us recollect what we discussed in the previous class. We had started with a new portion in the unit 3, clay mineralogy, that is about the fine grained material, about the soil structure, and also the structure of the clay minerals, what forms the forces, what are the valence bonds, and the soil water system, especially the diffuse double layer, and what causes the electrical layer to form, and what is meant by isomorphous substitution, and what is meant by cation exchange capacity or base exchange capacity. And also we had discussed about the different clay minerals, the three clay minerals which are of engineering significance, namely kyanite, ilmenite and montmorillonite. Today we will try to just briefly discuss about the last portion of the electrical diffuse double layer, adsorb water, base exchange capacity, and the some of the common clay minerals, and also the structure. Now this will be discussed from the examination point of view, and these are the previous year questions which have appeared in this particular portion. In 2001 March, for 4 marks, it has been asked like this: define the terms diffuse double layer water and exchangeable ions. Now we had discussed what is meant by the diffuse double layer, what is meant by electrical double layer, and why it is called a diffuse double layer. Now clay essentially is negatively charged. Okay, you can see here this clay is negatively charged, and because of that you will have the opposite charges which are coming. You can see here this figure, you can see this clay is negatively charged, you can see the ions being attracted. This acts as a cathode, and the ions which are attracted form two layers. So this is one layer and this is another layer. If you look into the system, you can see here it gets diffused. It's like a magnet. Near the magnet you will have more amount of the electrical forces or the magnetic force. With the distance, the magnetic force gets reduced. In the similar way, we have got one layer of the electrical negative charge, and you have got the positive charge which is there on the from the ions, and these two form two layers, and it gets diffused over a distance. If it's called diffused double layer, you can see here this is getting diffused. The charge concentration is more near the thing. You need to draw a neat diagram showing the clay particle, showing the negative charges on the clay surface, and the positive what you can see here, the positive ions which are surrounding the. You can have some water molecules also, because in water is a dipole, some of the positive charge will be attracted towards the negative charge of the clay particles. This you need to write about in brief. In the examination, it is very essential for you to draw a neat sketch, give explanation the point of bullets wherever possible. Now this is about the water. Next question: what is soil structure? List the principal types of natural soil structure and explain with the aid of a simple sketch any one of them. Basically, what is a soil structure? The soils which are formed because of the deposition, we get the soil structure. The other questions which have appeared is with schematic diagrams explain the flocculated and dispersed structures. In the previous question, he has asked what is the definition of structure, and then he is asking about the principal types of structures. Okay, you have got structures for coarse grain material and structures for fine grain material. We'll see what are those things. So now here in this question is in this paper in 2002, July-August 2002, for 5 marks, is asking about the flocculated structure and the dispersed structure. Now these are the essential structures for the fine grain material. Now again you can see some of the questions: what are the different types of structures that the soil particles form during and after deposition in fresh water? Discuss their characteristics. It has come for 6 marks. Now the other type of questions are: explain briefly the type of soil structure recognized in coarse grain soil deposits and fine grain soil deposits. It has been asked for 6 marks in 2005. Explain with neat sketches the different types of soil structures that can occur in nature. The different way of asking, most questions have appeared on this soil structure. Now we know what is meant by solid structure. The geometrical arrangement of soil particles with respect to one another in a soil mass is known as soil structure. The internal arrangement in the macro level. Engineering properties and the behavior of both coarse grained and fine grained soils depend upon the soil structure. Therefore, it is very much important. The macro level behavior, macro level behavior is having a influence with the structure, that is at the micro level. Then the different types of soil structures are the single grain structure, honeycomb structure and flocculent structure, and your dispersed structures. We will see what is a single grain structure, especially in cohesionless soils which get sedimented when it is getting eroded by the forces of this thing, especially the water, the fluvial deposits. When they are being removed by erosion because of the water movement of water, slowly when it goes and deposits, when the deposition takes place, the particles are, and they settle under the gravitational forces and they come to equilibrium. When they get deposited, individual particles go on settling, and they may be in a loose state or it may be in a dense state. These are all single, you can see the single grains settling independently. And at the point of contact, if you got any cementing material, it gets indurated, that is especially calcium carbonate or silicate, then it forms a cementing agent like this at this position, and it gets indurated. One example is the sandstones. It can get very good strength, it can be polished, but it is not a very good, it is a sedimentary rock which is undergoing deposition, and it has got indurated because of the cementing action. This is single grains. Now honeycomb structure, similar to our honeybee, it forms a comb. It will have all holes and cells. Okay. Similarly, if fine sands or silts get deposited, then what happens? The particles bridge like this and form a opening which has got a lot of voids. Now it gets indurated at the point of contact. This resembles a honeycomb. You can see here, this is in nature, it has happened. You can see the voids in between, the particles are having contact at the boundaries. So such kind of skeleton structures for especially fine grained fine portions of the coarse grain material, fine sands and fine silts. Hello, 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 hello. ಮೊದಲಿಂದ ಬಂದಿಲ್ವಾ? ಒಂದೆರಡು ಸ್ಲೈಟ್ ಹಿಂದೆ ಹೋಗಿ ಹೇಳ. ಹಲೋ 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 ಹನಿಕೋಮ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್ ಹಲೋ ಓಕೆ ಹನಿಕೋಮ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್. See, it is possible for fine sands or silts to get deposited such that the particles, when settling, they develop a particle to particle contact that bridges, similar to the single grain structure. But here what is happening, they are not settling one over the other, they form a bridge like this. Hello, 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 The previous slide we discussed about the single grain structure. In the fine grain, in the fine portion of the coarse grain material, they can either settle individually and lay one over the other when they are coarser in nature. When in the coarse grain material it becomes finer in nature, what happens, they form they get deposited like this and they try to bridge over each other and try to have contacts, and they form a open void like this, and because of this you can get a open structure which is called a honeycomb structure. This resembles a honeycomb, therefore it is called honeycomb structure. You can see a photograph clearly showing the honeycomb that has been formed. It happens when the particle size is very small, in the range of 0.002 mm and 0.02 mm. Now, flocculated structure. See, this flocculated structure and dispersed structure are the structures which can be seen for clay particles, fine grain material. This actually occur in clays, and these clays have got a very large surface area, and therefore the electrical forces are important in such soils. The clay particles have a negative charge on the surface and a positive charge on the edges. Only at the broken edges we can have some positive charges. More or less the whole portion of the clay portion will have the negative charge. As a consequence they develop attraction, and interparticular contact develop between the positively charged edges and the negative charge faces. This results in the flocculated structure. I will try to explain in the board what happens. See, you have got the clay structure. See, it's, if you take it as a plate, at the edges you may have some positive charges, and along the surface will have the negative charge. Now, this can get attracted towards another at the edges, it may have positive charges, otherwise we will have negative charge. Now, it can form like this, it tries to attract like this, we have the negative charge. Now, this positive charge and the negative charge get attracted, they get fixed there like this, and we can have another particle like this passing. We will have negative charges here, we have got the positive charge. This negative charge along the surface is going to attracted to the positive edges. This kind of edge to face arrangement is called the flocculant structure. You can see here, in this figure you can see here the edge to face arrangement is there. You can see in this, these are the hexagonal sheets. You can see the exo micro the electron microscope view, scanning electron microscope SEM. You can see here, this is one particle. You can see these sheets like this. Now, you the edge to face arrangement can be seen. You can see this one flock here, there is another flock here, you have got another edge to face arrangement, this is another flock here, there is edge to. Therefore, this one has been simplified and drawn like this, but actually in nature it happens like this because of the charges. Now, formulation of flocculant structure, I have told you how it happens. Dispersed structure. Now, when you have almost a parallel arrangement, when you have the particles, when there is some loading, what happens? Dispersed structures develop in clays that have been remolded. Means when you work out, okay, when you try to work out, the edge to face arrangement will become parallel orientation, and as a consequence, they get dispersed. Clay deposits with the flocculant structure when transported to other places by nature or man gets. Transported by man gets remolded. This external working, this converts the edge to face orientation to the face to face orientation. This structure is formed in nature when there is a net repulsive force between particles. Instead of having attractive force, but there is an external force which is trying to prevent the repulsion, then they come to close to each other like this, the parallel orientation, and they may form groups, and again they may be a group of parallel oriented particles having a edge to face arrangement. Now, we will go to the next portion. Name and explain the two fundamental building blocks of clay minerals. See, we discussed about the clay minerals, the three type of clay minerals, illite, kyanite, illite and monmonlite. There are some building blocks. See, there are two building blocks. Kyanite is a 1:1 clay mineral, and you got illite and monmonlite, which is a 2:1 clay mineral. Now, what are these 1:1 and 2:1? You got the silicon tetrahedron and aluminum octahedron. If one silica tetrahedron gets blocked with make a pairing with the aluminium octahedron, that is called 1:1 clay mineral. If you got two silicon tetrahedron to one aluminium octahedron, then we get the 2:1 clay mineral. Now let us see the varieties of other questions. With the aid of sketches, distinguish between principal clay minerals kyanite, montmorillonite, and illite. Then explain the following clay minerals with a sketch of their basic structural units. You got kyanite, montmorillonite. Also give their typical values of the specific surface area and base exchange capacity or cation exchange capacity. Now you can see here, these are the building blocks. We have seen here, this is the silicon tetrahedron and this gibbsite sheet, how they are represented as blocks. Okay, now the separate, you have to draw a diagram like this. You have to draw a diagram like this. Now to give a diagram like this and try to give the spacing, and you have to give the thickness of the clay mineral and the specific surface area. See, kyanite is more coarser in nature compared to the other two type of principal clay minerals. Therefore, we have to write the, you can see here the specific surface area, which is expressed as meter square per gram, is slightly less. When you come to, you can see in the kyanite, you got 1:1, one silica tetrahedron and one gibbsite sheet. Alumina octahedron is called gibbsite sheet. Here you got one silica tetrahedron and two gibbsite sheets are aluminium octahedron. So, one silicon tetrahedron and two aluminium octahedrons. This is called the 2:1 clay mineral. Now, the spacing has to be given. You have to draw a diagram like this and you need to give. See, the montmorillonite clay mineral, because of the presence of this montmorillonite, what happens, if you see in the previous thing, you got water, the there is no proper bonding between the two units, and what happens, the water molecules are attracted because of the high surface area. I will show you the scanning electron microscope. You will see how the increase in surface area, got both external surface area and internal surface area. Because of this increased surface area, there is a lot of surface activity, and along the surface you got the negative charge. It has got the tendency to attract the ions, and as a consequence there will be lot of surface activity, and as a consequence the micro level behavior is going to lead to a macro level changes. You can see the soil has cracked, it has shrinked like anything. You can see these cracks, and in the presence of water, what happens, it swells and it creates lot of problems to the buildings. I can show you some of the things. This is the physical properties. You can see here the 800 meter square per gram. You can see this the high surface area. Illite is in between. It has got a bond between you got the aluminium this potassium bond in between the potassium bond. You can see this potassium bond. Because this relatively compared to kyanite, it is having swelling, but compared to montmorillonite, the swelling is less because of the potassium bond being. It is kyanite has got a very strong hydrogen bond, whereas here we have got weak, relatively weak potassium bond. Whereas in the montmorillonite, you don't have any bond, you have got only water bond. It is very weak compared to the you can see the surface area is very less, 80 meters square per gram, whereas it is 10 times more for montmorillonite. You can see here, this is a very nice hexagonal sheets. You can see these hexagonal sheets. You see the hexagonal sheets here. It didn't work. You can see the hexagonal sheets of the kyanite. You can see the edge to flock, this flocculated nature also, edge to face arrangement. You can see this is the one unit. There is a the surface, the edge is getting attracted towards the surface. Now you can see this illite, relatively the surface area is more. You got more random arrangement of these particles. You can see here, this is montmorillonite. It can show, it can be seen that you got too much of surface area. You got external surface area and as well as internal surface area. This table summarizes all the properties here. You got the kyanite, you got illite and montmorillonite. You can see the kyanite is 1:1 silicate mineral, this is 2:1, and montmorillonite is also 2:1. You see the surface area between 5 to 30 for kyanite, whereas for illite it is around 70, and average value is around 80. We can take 70 to 175. Again, it depends upon the ions present, and you got the The Mon monolith, which has got a very high surface area, it is around 800, it goes up to, it depends upon the type of Mon monolith present. Now you can see the cation exchange capacity. Kyanite, because of the less surface area, you got a very low cation exchange capacity. The unit is centimole charges per kg, C mole C per kg is the unit. Earlier it used to be milli equivalent per 100 grams. Now this is the modern unit. Now coming to the illite, you got the charges 10 to 40. When come to Mont monolith, it is 80 to 150. Therefore, the surface activity is more. You can see this as a specific surface being 10, around 10, and for Mont monolith it is 800, and for illite it is 80. Now there is a question: Mont monolith is the most active clay mineral and kyanite is the least active clay mineral. Justify this statement with illustrations. You need to draw the basic blocks, building blocks, and you have to show that water molecule being present between the water bond between the basic units in the Mont monolith, whereas in kyanite it has got hydrogen bond, that you have to explain. And you can see, this is for your understanding. You can see here, this is the kyanitic soil. This does not swell or shrink much, because it has got a proper hydrogen bond, and these are formed in highly weathered soils. You can see, these are weathered in situ soils. Now you can see here, this is the picture of two pictures of the swelling nature of the Mont monolithic soils. You can see here, it has shrunk. Okay, there is a lot of volumetric activity. You can see there is a pen kept here for the idea, so that you can get what is the amount of width of the cracks developed here. You can see here, a hand has been placed. You can see more than the width of the hand. Okay, hand can easily pass inside. Therefore, it has got a lot of surface activity because of this only, because of the high surface area, and also the cation exchange capacity as a consequence of the high surface area. You can write all those values and explain what happens when there is a water, and what happens when there is no water. Field identification of tests. Okay, in the previous class I had discussed about this. I had thought of giving you some examples through live examples. I couldn't get the samples. In the next class, I'll show you some of the samples which are collected. How we can differentiate between sand and silt, and how we can differentiate between silt and clay, especially clay and silt. Okay, you can dust off the powder from the silt, whereas for clay it will be very hard. You try to break it, you can't break it. So one of the field tests to identify sand is you do a sedimentation test. You mix it in water. You should take a big jar, so that there is vertical height. You try to pour the soil. Once you stir it and allow it to settle, within 30 seconds you can see sand settling here at the bottom. Then after half an hour of some more minutes, you can see silt and coarse clay getting settled at the top, and we will have clear water on the, or maybe muddy water on the top. Okay. Now you can see here in this photograph, you can see here, you can mark after a few minutes or a few seconds, what happens, 30 seconds, you can see here the complete sand has been settled once you stir it. Later, the second mark, you can see here, this is the portion where you got the silt and clay portion, then you got water on the top. Now I wanted to show this dry shear strength. Anyway, I don't have the samples. We can try to break it. It will be so hard, you can't break the sample. Now, based on the plastic, because of the plastic nature, when it becomes dry, it becomes very hard. This is about the previous portion, previous chapter. Now, we will start with a new chapter, shear strength of soils. Now, looking into the syllabus, look here, concept of shear strength. What actually is shear strength of soils, and why it is important. Then Mohr strength theory, actually it should have been, okay. Next, Mohr strength theory means, what is Coulomb's theory, what is Mohr strength theory, then what is the combination of Mohr Coulomb theory, that we need to discuss. Then the conventional and modified failure envelope, total and effective shear strength parameters, concept of pore pressure, factors affecting shear strength of soils, sensitivity and thixotropy of clays. Now today we will discuss about the concept of shear strength. Then we will discuss about the Mohr theory. Before that, Coulomb's theory. Then we will come to what is meant by Mohr Coulomb theory. Now, discussing about the necessity for studying shear strength of soils. Now, what happens? All our engineering activity, any civil engineering activity has to comprise by taking the support by placing your structure into the soil, or you are going to, for example, you are going to take the structure and you are going to place it on a formed stratum. This may be one example, or you may have construction of pavements. You construct the This is the subgrade. Now, this is the bearing coat, this is the pavement, or you may have another example of a civil engineering activity wherein an embankment dam. In the first case, it is a footing, you are resting on the soil, it has to bear the load which is coming from the superstructure, it has to transfer and it has to disperse the load. Okay. Then the load coming from the wheel loads which are coming from the motors, that has to be transferred on to this pavement and it has to again disperse. Then you have got this embankment, this has to be stable because this is provided with a certain slope, it has to be stable, there may be a sliding of this slope. Now, in all these cases, I am just giving some typical examples, in all this civil engineering activity, shear strength is very important. See, two things, okay, whenever any material is subjected to external loading, it undergoes deformation and it offer some resistance before going to before undergoing deformation. That resistance is the stress, external reaction for the external loading is the stress. Now, this soil, when it is loaded beyond its capacity, it is going to fail. Soil is not good in tension, it is good in compression. When you try to apply this compressive load, it tries to bear the, there will be reaction from the soil, opposite reaction. This is the bearing capacity of the soil, then it essentially fails in shear. That is one of the reason why we need to, soils essentially fail in shear. Therefore, we need to look into the strength. If this is not taken care, what happens? Your building is going to fail because of the failure of the foundation soil, or the soil which is supporting the structure is going to lead to problem. Therefore, the strength of a material is the greatest stress it can sustain. And the safety of any geotechnical structure is dependent on the strength of the soil. If the soil fails, the structure founded on it can collapse. We will see, it is not a simple thing. I will show you some photographs which gives you a clear understanding of what happens if it is not properly taken into consideration. Engineers must understand the nature of the shearing resistance in order to analyze the soil stability problems, such as bearing capacity problems, you got the slope stability I've shown there, lateral earth pressure on a retaining structure than the pavement. In a retaining structure, what happens? It may be, so whenever I got a natural ground for utility, I try to, so for example, I got a ground like this, it is in the natural state, I want to make a vertical cut so that I can make an utility of the. When I make a vertical cut, I need to, if I make a vertical cut, it is not going to stand, okay, I will excavate this material, okay, this becomes, think of the past. Now, what happens, this can, it can't be made vertical. If it is vertical, again it comes and assumes its natural slope. Why it happens, I will discuss later. Now, this has to be supported. When I support this, the force which is coming in the lateral direction because of the soil which is trying to run, this has to be understood from the shear strength point of view. Otherwise, it is going to either it will slide this one, or it may overturn, or it may lead to bearing capacity failure of this foundation. Therefore, it is very essential to understand shear strength from many practical problems from civil engine. Let us see shear failure under foundation. When you try to load it here, the failure surfaces are developed and the surface may yield. Now, if you tell you will not understand, this has to be understood by recorded cases in history. In the beginning of the 19th century, in 1913, grain elevator in Canada, they were growing lot of wheat, they had to transport to, they had to export to various countries. Then they had to build a grain elevator, they had to store this grains. You can see these are the silos, you can see the vertical silos, they are of very great height. And when they were storing the grain, what happened? Suddenly it failed. This is a typical example of bearing capacity failure or a shear failure. You can see here the surface has heaved. In the previous testing I have shown you, when the shear failure surface takes place and the surface heaving can take place, it is a general shear failure case, and it will tilt to any one side. It may tilt to one side, either right or left. The same thing has happened here. You can see here there is a surface sieve here and this has failed. Of course, it is still in the working condition, it has been rectified. The west side, this side has sunk by 24 feet. You can see here in this next diagram, it has sunk by 24 feet. There is a depression there. It was tried to, it was rectified by using jacks. You can see some more details about this. There is a heaving, surface heaving here. This ground which was like this, it has moved to the top, and this is the failure surface which has taken place. Now, this is another photograph. Clearly, you can see the surrounding buildings are intact. There is a failure of the foundation soil, and the structure has collapsed. In the previous thing, I made a list what is going to happen. The consequence is that geotechnical failures are going to lead to structural failures of the foundation of the buildings. You can see in this photograph there is a mass wasting. So, you can see the natural slope, the slope is there is a mass wasting of the soil, there is a movement of the soil. Now, it may be in an embankment, it may be in any, so it may be in a canal, it may be in any highway embankments or railway embankments or water storage bodies. Whenever there is an inclined surface, it leads to failure. There will be a tendency for the failure to take place. We need to design in such a way that it will be able to take care, the slope that you are going to provide is going to be proper. If you want to design, you need to know the knowledge of shear strength soil is very essential as a parameter, input parameter to do the design. This is the dam, again the failure of the slope, it is analyzed only if you know the shear strength parameters. Now, you can see this is a beautiful photograph of a pavement failing, the adjacent of the pavement has failed, here also it has failed. You can see the amount of loss that is going to take, economic loss, and plus the impairment of the function of the structure. Now, the line diagrams of what we discussed, what is happening in the stiff footing, what happens? There may be a development of a failure surface and will have a movement. In embankment, there will be mobilization of the shear stresses, shear forces, and when a shear failure takes place, what happens? There will be this soil grains slide over each other along the failure surface, but there will be no crushing, but it will try to slide. Now, this is when the limiting condition takes place, there will be a relationship between the shear strength and the normal stresses. Now, we will try to see what is the relationship between these two. To understand that, first we should know, we have seen what is the necessity of understanding the shear strength of soil. We need to understand what is meant by shear strength. It is the capacity of a material to resist the internal and external forces which slide past each other. The particles are sliding past each other and there is some equilibrium, there is some disturbance. There will be external forces, then internal forces. Then when there is disturbance like this, it leads to the mobilization of the resistance. It is like this. I have money, unless there is a requirement, I do not use it. Similarly, when there is external stress, the soil develops the resistance to the external loading, that is the strength, the capacity of the soil to resist the external load. Now, look here, you got this soil particles along the particle contact. You can see when there is a movement and there is shearing taking place along the contact, there will be a resistance. Therefore, the shear strength of a soil is its resistance to the shearing stresses. It is a measure of the soil resistance to deformation by continuous displacement of its individual soil particles. Shear strength in soils depends primarily on interactions between particles, because the point to point contact stress is going to give some resistance in some other types of soils, because we do not have only one type of soils, we have got cohesionless soils and cohesive soils. In the cohesive soils, we have got the other type of resistance that is going to develop. Therefore, shear failure occurs when the stresses between the particles are such that they tend to slide past each other or roll past each other. The components, what are the components which contribute to the shear strength of soil? Like you have got in a running a factory or anything, you have got contributors, partner A, partner B, like this, we got some contributions from coming from the soil. Which are those parameters which try to contribute? You have got the cohesion, which is not actually cohesion, it is a cohesion intercept. How you determine this thing? This may be because of it may be because of the cementation between the sand particles. I told you, when the particles deposit, individual particles at the point of contact, there may be some carbonate material coming and depositing and getting indurated, okay, it becomes bonded, or it may be because of the electrostatic attraction present between the clay particles. We have seen the in the previous slides what happens at the particle to particle contact. Because of the charges, we get this electrostatic attraction. Then it may be because of the frictional resistance. You saw in the previous thing, you can see at the point to point contact, you have got the frictional resistance, and you may have also interlocking. You can see here some particles have got interlocked here. You can see at this point, you can see at this point, you can see the contact is there, and it has got fixed inside. If the sliding has to take place, it has to get displaced, and that getting in fixed inside is called the interlocking. The interlocking stresses have to be removed, and then only we can develop the shearing. Now, let us further understand this thing. Shear strength of soils, we may have cohesion. Cohesion may come in the form of cementation for the dry sands, or some sands we may not have cementation. Okay, if you do not have cementation, then there will be no cohesion for sands. Then for clays, you have soft clays which have got less amount of cohesion, you got stiff clays which has got more amount of cohesion, depends upon the surface activity. Now, in a clay, you got the at the point to point contact, you got the cohesion, whereas in this case, you got the frictional resistance. How does this phi come into picture? The phi is the angle of internal friction. This friction between the particles is represented by angle of internal friction. It is a measure of the shear strength of soil due to friction. Now, when you try to slide past any block, you can see here there is a frictional resistance, and this frictional resistance is because of the angle of repose. What is meant by angle of repose? If you try to drop a sand material, you can see we are trying to pour sand here, it is forming a natural slope. Once it forms its angle of repose, any material that you are going to pour, it is the sand particles are going to roll past each other, and it forms this natural gradient. It is its angle of repose. This angle of repose is equal to the angle of internal friction. Now, this can be tested in a laboratory in the form of a shear test and try to ascertain the properties. We will see in the subsequent classes how to get this property. Now, angle of repose is dependent upon the particle size. It will be more for larger particles, and the friction will be less. Therefore, the angle of repose will be less. For you take gravel, it will have a more steeper slope compared to sand. Then particle shape, if you got angular particles, then it will be having a, you can form a steeper slope. Then shear strength, it also depends upon the shear strength. If you got higher shear strength of the soil, then you will have higher angle of repose. Now, stresses, we have normal stresses or shear stresses. In the previous slides, I showed you, you got this, this is the normal stress and this is the shear stress. This photo has not come, okay. Now, the soil is a particulate medium, it has got individual particles. At the point to point contact, we will have the stress. We will have the another phase called the liquid phase. You also got the air. Now, we need to understand a very important concept if you want to understand shear strength of soil, the principle of effective stress. This was given by Terzaghi, the founder of soil mechanics. What he says is, at the particle to particle contact, what happens? If you got a water medium which is there inside, when you try to apply the external load and try to shear it, what happens? This load will be taken by water, it shows as excess hydrostatic pressure, and the water gets squeezed out, and the remaining stress will be the point to point contact stress that is effective in taking the load. Therefore, you are not going to take the total stress is the external loading that is represented as sigma, and the pore water pressure which is developed is represented as u. The remaining, the summation is the difference is called the effective stress. This is effective in taking the external loading. Now, if this effective stress becomes 0 in soils, it becomes a liquid and it starts flowing. What are the factors influencing shear strength? The composition and its state. See, depending upon the grain size distribution and the shape of the particles, you will have, and also the pore fluid present and also the iron presence in the soil, it is going to influence. And also initial state, whether it is in a loose condition or in a dense condition, or for clay soils it is, whether it is stiff or soft, it is going to affect. And the structure being present, depending upon the type of structure, the type of voids present, it is going to, the cementation and all those factors are going to. Therefore, it is very complex to formulate the shear strength. Now, how to formulate with all these variabilities? The soil is not a homogeneous medium. It is having lot of complexity. It has got lot of variability. It is not isotropic, homogeneous material. It is a particulate medium. It has got lot of variables. And water is one of the important variable which contributes to the variations in the strength. Therefore, in reality, if you want to complete, have a complete shear strength formulation, you have to account for all these factors, and it is very difficult. Let us see more independently and Coulomb independently. Actually, first Coulomb gave the failure criterion, then later Moore gave it, and it was combined. Coulomb in the 18th century, he gave a functional relationship for the shear strength, and later Moore gave the formulation of in the form of more stresses, more circles. Now, let us look into the Coulomb's failure criterion. Here he said that the shear stress, the shearing stress that is going to develop on the failure surface at failure, is a function of normal stress. This usually I give an example like this. So, for example, I got a box like this, I need to shear it, it has got some sulphate. When I try to shear off, depending upon the weight, the shear stresses are developed. Instead of one, I place a pile of 10 boxes like this. When I want to pull this, the shear stresses developed will be more, because the number of boxes are more, the normal stress is more. Therefore, the shear stress required is more. Therefore, shear stress is a function of normal stress. This was given by Coulomb. Later, what he said, what Moore did is, he said that at failure, I can at any stage I can try to draw a Mohr circle and try to represent the state of stress. Initially it is a point, then I get a Mohr circle like this at different stage of loading, it comes like this. Now, the function relationship of tau is a function of normal stress, a linear relationship. This is the equation. Now, once it comes and touches tangentially to this failure line or the failure envelope, it is going to fail. That is what Moore said. The combination of these two is called the Moore-Coulomb equation or Moore-Coulomb theory, and the failure takes place because of the critical combination of the normal stress and shear stress. See, when you take a specimen and try to shear off any material, it will have, you can try to find out innumerable number of planes, and on these planes we will have a combination of normal stress and shear stress. The failure is going to take place on only one plane. That plane we have got the critical combination of normal stress and shear stress. On some other plane, normal stress may be more than the failure plane. On some other plane, the shear stress may be more than the the failure plane. But on the failure plane on which it is going to fail, it has got the critical combination of both these two stresses. You can see here in this, you got this failure plane, okay, you got this normal stress and the failure stress, you got the major principal stress. Here the, you got only the normal stress, you do not have any shear stress acting on this plane. Here also on this vertical plane, you got only the normal stress. Therefore, on this failure plane which is going to take place, you got both normal stress and shear stress, and it is critical combination. Now, we will try to see, this was the Moore Coulomb failure criterion, but actually for soil, for when Moore said it, he said it will be not a line, it will be a curved line this, and the failure Moore circle will be at the failure, it will touch tangentially, it will be tangential to the curved failure surface. Now, the combination of these two, actually what happens here, we are trying to linearize within the range of your stress that is going to take place in soil mechanics practice. Therefore, it is given as a equation in this form. Some soils may have cohesion, therefore, it may not cut the origin, it may cut the y axis, you may have some vertical intercept. This is called cohesion. Truly speaking, it is not cohesion, it is called the cohesion intercept. It is how we are going to get geometrically by plotting this data. And the angle of interfriction, the slope of this line is called, this angle is called phi. Therefore, the tau is function of C plus sigma tan phi. This is the equation of the straight line. This equation is called the Moore Coulomb failure envelope. Now, this is what I have represented in another slide. Now, this is the cohesion component and this is the frictional component. Okay, you got any questions? You can feel free to ask me. This, I made an introduction to this shear strength of soils. In the subsequent classes, we will discuss about the concept of getting these parameters through the laboratory tests and how these are realized in the field. Of late, it is more important to do a test in the field rather than the laboratory. We will see how the shear strength of a soil is not unique. It depends upon certain things. We will discuss about why it is not unique and on what it depends and how to determine these things in the laboratory and also in the field. And also we will work out some numerical examples. We will see what are the questions appeared in the previous year papers and try to get you prepared for the examination. If you got any questions, please feel free. Okay, thank you.